We have Jeff Migliozzi here. We're going to hear from him. He's going to give us a personal perspective on the world for the blind. Jeff is legally blind from birth, but he never attended a special school for the blind. He did, however, go to a very small high school in New Jersey. When he started, there were 70 kids in his whole school, and when he graduated, it was down to 39. He attended Uppsala College in New Jersey, where he received a bachelor's in English literature and philosophy. Then he attended Boston University, where he received a master's in reading and language. He was interested in adult literacy as a career, and when he couldn't find regular work, he decided to get his master's in education for the visually impaired from Boston College. He did his pre-practicum at Perkins, and that's how he got there. When he first applied for Perkins, there were no teaching jobs, so he worked in a brand new program that Perkins had developed for blind, multi-impaired adults who were transitioning out of the big institutions. He eventually ran that program for 11 years, and he began teaching in the secondary program in the fall of 1999. He primarily teaches English and sex ed, and has spent a lot of time recently on developing a sex ed curriculum and film course for the visually impaired. And Jeff's going to fill in the gaps for us right now, so let's give him our warmest welcome.
Well, thank you very much. I'm thrilled to be here. And I'm thrilled that you're here. I'm very impressed with your dedication to this program. Joe's told me, or I guess I'm supposed to call you Doc.
No.
Doc's told me how much time you guys put in, and that's amazing. So I really appreciate it. And I assume that some of you are interested in continuing in special education, and maybe some of you are just here to help out and learn about other people and other needs. And whatever your ultimate goal is, I just want to, applaud you for your dedication in doing this. It sounds like a wonderful program, and I'd like to keep in touch and find out more as things go on, how you guys are doing, because this is very impressive. So I want to talk about several different things today. I want to talk to you about what it is to teach people who are visually impaired. I also want to talk to you about what it's like to be visually impaired. Hopefully I can give you some tips for things to think about as you're going through your own education. And also want to be able to tell you about the Perkins School for the Blind, and also to give you a little more information on the issues of why I think teaching film and why I think sex ed are so important to the visually impaired. So that's what's on my agenda. But as Doc has said, raise your hand. To me, the best part about being a teacher is what I learn from the experience. And so I really want to hear from you. And if I'm going off in a direction that you don't want to hear about, you could ask me a question to get me back on topic. So whatever works is I'm very easy that way. So does that make sense, everybody? Yes. We good? All right. So the other thing is that as a blind person, I don't get all the cues, obviously. I can't tell if the guys in the back are, checking out sports scores on their iPhones and not paying attention to me or not. So I'm going to trust that you're all paying attention. And then if Doc thinks you're not, he can redirect me some other way. But
well, I can see them.
That's right. So let me tell you the first thing that I say to people, and I have an opportunity to talk a lot about blindness. I talk to parents. I talk to students. I talk a lot. But God bless you. One of the things I say is the older I get, the more profound a disability I realize blindness is, and the more comfortable I am with that fact. Because I have a life. I am 55 years old. I'm married. I have a daughter who's currently in Beirut. I worry about her all the time, but I'm a parent. There are things that I can't do. There are things that I've missed out on. I'm very well aware of that. The older I get, the more aware of that I am. But, we fill in the gaps. Not everybody gets to do everything in life. And so you just have to understand that. When you're young, the whole world is just one exciting place, and you throw yourself into it, and you don't really stop and think about it. And God bless you for that. You're at that point now in your lives, and you're learning a lot of new things. And, you know, so I have the perspective of a little distance. And so it's one of the things that I'm able to do with my students is I'm able to say to them, you know, there are things you miss. There are things we miss, and you need to know they're there. You need to understand how the sighted world operates, because regardless of the fact that you're blind, you're living in a sighted world. People see you even if you don't see them, and that's a very important concept, okay? Now, at the Perkins School for the Blind, but at any student who is visually impaired, we have essentially two curricula. We have the normal course load, you know, the core curriculum, math, science, everything that you guys need to do, MCAS, we have all that. And then we have what's called the expanded core curriculum. And what the expanded core curriculum is are classes that blind students need to take to learn about the world that you guys, who are not blind, learn just through incidental learning, just by moving through life. For example, mobility, you know, using a long cane to travel. You know, nobody taught you how to walk around the neighborhood. You know, you kind of learn that, you know, or maybe your parents said, you know, don't go past, you know, that block or whatever until you're older. But you essentially learn just by watching, you know, other kids, you know, how to move around, you know, where things are, where the store is, where the mailbox is, where the post office is. Our students have to be taught that. So that's an example of expanded core. Cooking skills. You know, you may have learned to cook or not cook based on what your parents did, but, you know, generally speaking, you could observe the world and then you could then follow the lead and essentially learn how to do it. Our students have to learn special techniques because they can't see how other people do it, and the way other people do it won't work for them. Pouring, measuring, everything like that has to be done somewhat differently. So that's part of the expanded core. Every so often, you know, we find that we have to add subject areas. One of the most recent ones was actually self-advocacy, because what we were finding is a lot of our students don't really know how to advocate for themselves. And once you turn 18, you know, up until you're 18, your parents can do all the talking for you. Once you turn 18, the law requires that you ask for the accommodations you need. They can't do that for you. Nobody else can. So we have to teach our students how to ask for accommodations under the ADA, the Americans with Disabilities Act. You know, if here at Bridgewater State, I have a number of former students of mine who are here. And one of the things I know is that you have a very good Disabled Student Services office. But they have to request the services. Nobody's going to come to them and say, hey, you're going to need somebody to help you with note-taking. Or are you going to need somebody to help you if you're in a wheelchair, you know, get in and out of bed in the morning? You know, we know, we understand that those are things that you might need, but you have to ask for them. We're not going to come and, you know, ask you. And so that's, we have to teach that. So that's part of the expanded core curriculum. So what you guys learn just through observing and incidental learning, we have to teach directly. And that's what the expanded core curriculum is. And so that's the kind of stuff we do. And one of the areas that I'm particularly interested in is sex education, because what I say about blindness is, I love words. You know, I love language. That's how I get the world brought to me. You know, I love Shakespeare. I love Bob Dylan. I love John Steinbeck. I love, you know, Gertrude Stein and Sylvia Plath and Walt Whitman. And, you know, this is rich, wonderful stuff for me. I couldn't imagine a life without words. But there is a world out there. There is a world without words. And there's information out there that you get just naturally. You can walk into a museum and look at a painting. You can look at a nude and you can see where everything is, right? You can recognize that. Okay, oh, that's a woman's body. That's a man's body. Oh, okay, that's what it looks like. Blind students don't get that. They don't get that information. You can go to the beach and you can see, okay, people wear all different kinds of bathing suits, but there are certain parts that are covered always and some parts that are optional. That's information you have just through living. That's incidental learning, just by being there. Just by showing up, you're seeing those things. Our students have to be told those things, and that's really the heart of the expanded core curriculum. The problem with sex education is if we're relying on words, if we're relying on people to tell us about the world around us, we as Americans don't talk honestly about sex. So it's a double whammy if you're blind, because you know, you're relying on people to tell you stuff and they ain't talking. So, you know, so somebody has to fill that gap. And I believe that sex education is actually as much a part of the expanded core curriculum as anything, because it's information that we have to teach directly that you guys get incidentally. Okay, we do the regular sex ed, but we also have to add on, you know, we have to take a step back and say, you know, before we even begin, we have to give you fill in the gaps about the world around you. So I find that to be a very good metaphor, okay, yeah, just for life in general, the world without words. You know, one of the questions that that Doc had sent out, he mentioned about sports, and I love sports. I'm a big sports fan, particularly baseball. And in fact, I don't know if any of you would remember this, but WEEI used to have a baseball show on Sunday mornings. And I used to be a regular caller. I was Jeff from Watertown. And I would call and talk about baseball because I love the game. I love the strategy of it. But the game of baseball was brought to me through, you know, Dave O'Brien and Joe Castiglione and Trubiano and those people, you know, going back, you know, way back before that. I don't know what it's like to see a fly ball and decide for myself if it's fair or foul, if it's going to go out or if it's going to be caught. I can't tell you if that strike was really a strike or an inch off the plate. You get that experience just from observing. I have to wait for the announcer to tell me, and then I have to ask my friends, like, what did you think? Was he really safe or was he out? Okay, but it doesn't take away from the game. I still enjoy the game, but there's things that I'm not going to experience, and I just have to accept that, you know? And some things aren't worth it. You know, I wouldn't go to a silent movie. I might have somebody tell me about it. I'd be very curious to know about it. I like to hear about paintings, but I'm not going to go stand there and not get anything out of it. That's just, again, that's an example of when I say, I have a rich life, but it's different. How am I doing? Am I making sense here? Are people interested in this? Am I? Are folks in the back nodding out? No. Doc, are we okay?
I'm keeping an eye on everyone. Everyone seems so far one or two slouchy, but their eyes are open. That's
okay.
The most important
thing. All right. Well, let me tell you. A little bit about growing up. Let me take a step back even further. Let me tell you about how I understand sensory and disability. Okay, as just mentioned, my bachelor's degree was in English literature and philosophy, and I often say that the most practical classes I ever took. And I'm not talking about what you're doing here. I'm not talking about, you know, clinical experience. I'm not talking about working, you know, I'm not talking about my practicums and my pre-practicums. That's the best education you're going to get, is actually doing the job. What you're doing here today is going to serve you so well in the future because you're doing it. And so this is the best experience you can have, is working with students, finding out about their needs, analyzing, discussing, the team building, the clinical stuff, all that stuff is fabulous. That's the best education you're going to get. But in terms of classroom teaching, in terms of sitting in a class and learning, the most practical classes I took were my philosophy classes. That sounds crazy, right? If it doesn't sound crazy to you, go home, try this experiment. Go home and tell your parents that you've decided to major in philosophy and see what kind of reaction you get from them. Because they're probably going to say, who's going to pay you to stare at your navel? Who's going to pay you to question the existence of the world, right? I mean, it doesn't sound like a very practical degree. But I'll tell you why, for me, it was such a practical degree. In the course of my studying philosophy, I came upon the German, I guess he was an empiricist, Immanuel Kant. I can't quote you chapter and verse about this man. I read a lot of his stuff. It was very dense, but there were some key concepts that I learned. And one of them was, you know, he talked about the fact that human beings are being bombarded with sensations. Just sitting here right now, you're registering, your eyes are registering a flood, a torrent of information is pouring into your brain through your eyes. same with your ears, the same with your skin, okay? It's a little chilly, right? You're picking that up. You're hearing my voice, you're looking at me. Maybe you're sensing a little hunger, whatever, you know. And somehow all this constant bombarding of stimulation somehow is going into your brain, and your brain is taking all that information and it's organizing it. And it's moving, you know, it's moving the visual stuff over here and the sound over there, and it's cross-checking, okay, I see that and I hear that, so he's the person speaking, you know, your brain is doing this automatically, and somehow, through all the stimulation, you come up with something that is a reality for you, right? This is the world that you perceive, and then you and your friends get together, you develop languages, you know, you have common, you know, points that you're focusing on, and you create the world. You create a reality. Every moment, every day, you're creating the reality, right? I'm part of that reality, but my reality is a little different than yours. Because one of those avenues, one of those floodgates has been closed. And I don't get all the visual stuff that you do. So in your reality, you get up in the morning, you brush your teeth, you come to school, you walk around, you find your class. I live in a world where I do some of those things, but also I live in a world where, you know, I walk down the street and somehow a giant tree branch jumps out in front of me and whacks me in the head. Or the sidewalk comes up and trips me. Okay, now, you know what? Literally doesn't do that. But that's what it feels like, right? Because I can just be bopping along, you know, it's in the morning, I'm heading to the bus, and bam! Because I'm a little bit off to the side, I hit the tree, right? That's my reality because I don't get that visual information. So, you know, you and I are, yes, we're both together, and we're both in this world, but my reality is a little bit different than from yours because of the fact that I don't get the visual information. Does that make sense? You see what I'm saying? So, and again, don't feel sorry for me. That's not why I'm saying it. I'm just letting you know that we have to compensate, okay? Now, you know, you hear all the time about, blind people have extra gifts. You know, they can hear better, or they can sense better, or they're musically in tune. Let me tell you, I have no musical talent at all. So, you know, Stevie Wonder, God love him. Ray Charles, God love him. You know, but that ain't me. That ain't me. So, but anyway, I don't know if Roy Orbison was visually impaired. He certainly wore the dark glasses, though. He loved those Ray-Ban wraparounds. He loved those. But what we do is, you may have heard, and I recently attended a workshop with a man named Latvi Marabet. He's a neuroscientist and an ophthalmologist, and he talks about the brain a lot. And you may have heard this idea that we only use 20% of our brains. That's malarkey. We use 100% of our brains all the time. Okay, our brains are, that's what brings us the world. And the brain, there is a lot of plasticity to the brain. So the brain does adjust. Even with blind people, they can do these MRI, they're called fMRIs, functional magnetic resonating, where they can actually see what parts of the brain are being stimulated just through everyday tasks. And the visual cortex, even for the blind, is being stimulated. You know, we're using that brain, that part of the brain, for something, some way of processing the world. So we are, you know, still using our, using our brains all the time, but we're just creating a somewhat different reality, and we're adjusting and we're adapting. And as teachers of the visually impaired, our job is to teach to that, to help our students develop that, to use that plasticity, to help, you know, the fact that it can be molded. We our job is to help them mold it so they can make sense. So for me, growing up, I was very fortunate because, I had wonderful. I grew up in a very rich Italian, warm Italian neighborhood. Kind of like something you might see on The Sopranos. Everybody knew everybody. Everybody was related. In some way, if not in this country, in the old country, you know, going back generations, you know, people moved, they settled, they told their friends came, they settled. So, in my neighborhood, even though I was blind, everybody sort of thought of me as hard of seeing. You know, I was sort of like, well, you know, Jimmy has trouble seeing, but he, you know, pretty much he can, you know, he can. So I would do things like ride a bike. I would be able to help neighbors carry things. People expected me to work, you know. It was just part of, you know, yeah, he had a little trouble seeing, but, you know, so what? You know, that was that kind of thing. when I rode a bike, I will tell you that when I rode a bike, my grandfather taught me to yell "Leva Danans," which apparently is something you yell like when a bull gets loose in the old country. It's, you know, it's sort of look out, but it's look out with meaning. You know, it's and so I would ride my bike up and down the street yelling "Leva Danans" up and down the street, and everybody would know to get out of my way. But that was very important because what often happens, and this is very important for you to think about, especially if you go on in special education. if I walk into a room full of strangers, the first thing they want to do is sit me down as soon as they can. They want to get me in a chair. You know, oh, you mean, because I might trip over something, I might fall over something. So they want to get you in a chair, and then every time you go to move, they're going to bring you something. Oh, what can I get you? You want to get, you know, we take a lesson, you know. And what ends up happening is if that happens to you when you're a child and you're growing up with everybody bringing you everything and telling you you don't have to bother and, oh, the rules don't apply to you, we're going to do it, you know, you're going to end up developing what I call the narcissism of disability. You're going to end up growing up thinking the rules don't apply to me, the world comes to me, I don't go out to the world. And at some point, that ends, and all of a sudden, you're in the world and you're not able to function because you're expecting everything to be done for you. So it is very important. It was very important to me growing up that I always expected to work. Now the blindness community, you hear numbers like, you know, 70% are unemployed or underemployed. I have some theories about why that is. But you know, part of it is the fact that, you know, we don't necessarily instill a work ethic because the rules don't apply to the blind. Everything should come to them. So it's very important that you encourage young people growing up to be involved. You know, to have chores, to have, you know, to contribute, to be part of the community, whatever they to the best that they can, whatever their disability is, to have something. And they may not be able to do the same job you do, but have something to contribute so that they don't feel like the rules never apply to them. Because if you've ever been around people who think, you know, the world is their oyster and the rules don't apply to them, they're usually pretty annoying people. They're the people that cut in line. They're the people that cut you off when you're driving. They're the people that jump in and take the parking spot that you had every right to, that you were lined up to pull into, and they cut in behind you and stole it from you. Those are the people who think the rules don't apply to them. And they're not very likable people. So it's very important that we instill in our students, regardless of the disability, the fact that they should participate and be part of, you know, have expectations. I never for a minute thought I wasn't going to have a job. And you know, I was on SSI for a couple of years when I got out of one graduate school and started the other. But, you know, it was a very short period of time, and I've been contributing back to the economy for like 30 years now. So, you know, that's a good model. That's how it's supposed to work. So that's a very important thing to keep in mind. So when I grew up, I had that experience. So I went to this very small private school. Now, the reason I went to the school was not a special needs school, but the reason that I went to the school was the fact that I grew up in Jersey City, and my parents, you know, the Jersey City school system was not very good at the time. My cousin is now a principal in Jersey City, so I'm assuming it got better since I left. But at the time, it was not a very good school system. And so they wanted me to go to a private school, and they were able to afford it. This was not fancy. We had no tennis courts. We had no swimming pool. It was just a big house with a lot of kids. But the great thing was that I got attention. Now, back in those days, there were no computers. This was the Stone Age. There wasn't a lot of adaptation. I actually had, you know, nowadays you have these digital books, you know, and e-readers, right? I used to use reel-to-reel tape recorders. I used to have these spools of tape that were my books. You know, Mark Twain's Connecticut Yankee and King Arthur's Court. I'd have to wrap it around and have this big clunky machine, and that's how I would read. But there wasn't a lot of technology. So basically what I got was a lot of attention. And so if I needed something, you know, I had teachers who instinctively knew, oh, Jeff's not going to know how to do that because he can't see it, so we're going to show it to him. So they were doing expanded core before anybody talked about expanded core because they had the time to pay attention to me, and they had the time to observe me. And I remember the best teacher I ever had was a fellow named Michael Higgins. He was not the hippest, coolest guy, okay? we had teachers, you know, we had teachers with long hair who played in bands and, you know, used to write songs about Nixon, and, you know, they were cool, but they weren't really the best teachers. We had, you know, there were some pretty cute young female teachers that a lot of the male students liked a lot, but, you know, they weren't my best teachers either. Michael Higgins was a boring guy. He wore, for the first 2 years I knew him, he had the same gray sport jacket. Everybody talked about this gray sport jacket. And then 1 year, his wife forced him to get a new jacket, and he came in with this powder blue blazer on. And you would have thought, like, Bob Dylan went electric, we landed on the moon. People were like, whoa, what happened? I mean, this is how, you know, very staid a gentleman he was. But the thing that Michael Higgins said to me that nobody else had said to me is, you got to do the work that everybody else does. I learned to type in the eighth grade because my handwriting was so poor that only my, you know, very few people could actually read what I wrote. And so what ended up happening is I would write something in hand, and then the teacher would have to ask me about it, and I'd have to respond orally. Somebody said, you know, you got to learn how to type. And I didn't want to learn how to type, but I'm so glad I did. So I learned how to type. But I used to type in all caps, no punctuation. And teachers were so happy to be able to finally read what I was writing, they didn't care, because they were reading for content. So they just wanted to know, you know, does he understand the concepts? So one day Michael Higgins, he cleared out basically a big closet, put a desk there, put a typewriter there, and said, this is going to be your workspace. And, you know, you're not leaving here until you're using punctuation, you're indenting. And he made me do what everybody else was doing. And, you know, that was the greatest lesson of my life. I mean, once I got it, you know, I had it. And now I teach my students that. You know, I teach my students even the physical layout of the printed page, what an indentation is. I have my students read punctuation out loud so they can hear where the commas naturally fall and where the periods naturally fall and the exclamation marks naturally fall. Because if all you do is auditory, you don't get any, language just becomes like a flowing river. If all you're doing is listening to books on tape, you know, or digital downloads, or however you do it now, you know, it doesn't have form to it. You know, the written language has form to it. So that's why Braille is important, and that is why, you know, the visual layout of language is so important. So we have to teach that. Okay. I should also tell you that I did have some vision growing up, and so back in the 60s, they had what was called the sight first movement. And the idea was if you had any vision, you were supposed to use it. That Braille was somehow, I don't know, stigmatizing or, I mean, and part of it was they didn't have a lot of people to teach Braille. So unless you really needed it, you didn't get it. And so I never got Braille growing up. I would read large print pages. The books were like this big, literally. You lugged them around. They were like in 7 volumes. You know, you might have one textbook, you know, this big. Mine would be, you know, 7 volumes of large print. And I would read it with a thick pair of glasses and then another set of glasses that clipped on over that. So double lenses, a reading lamp over my shoulder, and this large print big book on a stand. And that would be how I would read. And the thing is, I could read, I could see the letters to this day. I can picture. I still, when I go to spell something, I picture the letters in my head. I don't picture Braille. I picture the letters in my head. But the problem is, that worked great in the 3rd grade, that worked great in the 5th grade, that worked great, you know, okay in the 7th grade. By the time I got to high school, I could not keep up. I could not read that way. And I didn't get Braille. I mean, I can do basic Braille now. I can label my CDs and I can make notes for myself in Braille, but I can't really read Braille. But I'm a huge believer in Braille because it gives you that structure of language. It is the basics. And blind people, the power goes off. They can still read if they know how to read Braille. They don't need it. So I'm a firm believer in Braille. I didn't get it. So I think that's one of the reasons why I'm such a strong advocate for it, because I really understand how valuable it was and I wish I'd had it. But the reason I bring up this is that I never, you know, every now and then, I was doing fine in high school. I had friends. I was very, very, very much part of the environment. I had a great childhood. But every now and then, somebody would say, you know what? He should go to the Perkins School for the Blind. And I'd be like, why? You know, yeah, because it's Perkins. It's the greatest school for the blind. It's been there since 1829. That's where every blind kid should go, you know. And I'd be like, why? You know, I'm in Jersey City, I'm fine, I have my friends here, why do I need to go to the Perkins School for the Blind? And they'd be like, well, you know, because it is, it's there. Okay, I never went. And my attitude was sort of like, you know, who needs the Perkins School for the Blind? You know, I'm happy. And, you know, it wasn't until graduate school, and they sent me to Perkins, that I really understood what Perkins was. And I have to admit, I went in with kind of a negative attitude. And after, you know, 10 minutes, I was like, this place is great. But, you know, not everybody, I'm transitioning now to the history of Perkins a little bit. Does that make sense? Are you following me? Okay. All right. So here I am. I grew up in a regular public school, a regular private school, but, you know, regular education. And now I find myself at the Perkins School for the Blind. All right. So, you know, there are people who will tell you, we should abolish all schools for the blind. We should abolish all residents, and some of them are being. Some states are closing their schools for the blind. And the reason is, and you guys, I'm sure, talk about this a lot. I remember it was in some of the questions that Doc had showed me, inclusion, right? The inclusion movement. Students should be included in the public schools where they, in their neighborhoods, where their friends are going, where their peers are going. Inclusion is the most important thing, right? Have you guys heard that? You guys know about the inclusion movement? Okay. And I don't disagree, but one of the things I want you to remember, I want you to think about, if you haven't thought about it already from this point forward, is that inclusion serves education. Education does not serve inclusion. The reason we have these laws is these are laws about education. Every student is entitled to a free and appropriate education, and the key word there is appropriate. To your parents, it's free, but to you, the key word is appropriate, right? Because it's what works for you. And not every kind of school system works for every kind of kid. That's why we have charter schools now for artistic kids, gifted kids, math and science kids, vocational kids, right? I mean, there's a natural selection. Some kids need different types of education, and a residential school fits there just as well. Yes. If you can get everything you need in the public school, God bless you, go for it. That's what we want. And we often send kids back to public school once they've learned what they needed at Perkins, send them back to public school. We're not against public school. We're not against inclusion. Some school districts think we are, but we're not. You know, but again, inclusion serves education. I use the example, I was talking to Doc's wife today on the ride up here. And I, you know, my daughter in the third grade, they had a hamster, right? They had the hamster in the third grade. They read to the hamster. They took the hamster out on recess. The hamster was there for math and science. The hamster, you know, got taken home. The hamster was there. That hamster wasn't getting educated. It was included, right? It was included in the class. It wasn't getting educated. It was there, right? And too often we have seen students who come to us after years of not getting the skills they needed, where if the public school was able to provide them earlier, they wouldn't have to come to us. But now they've got to come to us, and now they've got to play catch up. And so, you know, and we have a tremendous team. You know, you go to a clinical meeting, you know, or an IEP meeting at our school, and you will have 12, 13 people there. You know, you'll have the major subjects, math, science, English, but you'll also have the mobility person, you might have a speech person, you might have a braille person, you might have a counselor there, because for some students, they need, you know, again, if you go back to my initial premise about you're being bombarded with stimulation and your brain's organizing it, well, for our kids, some of that stuff has to be taught to them, so that whole team comes to represent. So the occupational therapists deal with the tactile stuff. And that stuff, right? So they're getting the information they need, you know, through their fingertips and through their hands. You know, the mobility person is teaching the travel skills. They're all there, concentrated to bring this kid to a point where either they can continue on at Perkins or they go back to the public school. We love to send kids back to the public school. Math and science, it takes our kids longer. You know, the brightest kids, it still takes longer to get math and science because of the adaptations. You know, math began as a measuring system. It was a visual concept. You know, people needed to know, like, how do we know how far something is? Or how do we know how to build, you know? And so it's a very visual concept. Yes, our students can get that, right? Our students can, you know, and some students are better than others, just like some of you are probably better at math than others. But it usually takes us about a year and a half to teach a year's worth of math to one of our students. And if they're not particularly gifted, it might take 2 years. And now with MCAS and you having the, you know, so a lot of times you will have students who will come to us just to learn those things and some independent living skills and then go back to the public schools. Some kids will come to us and stay the whole time. Now, another reason why school districts often are reluctant to send kids to Perkins is it costs anywhere from 2 to 5 times, depending on the disabilities.
Yeah, I have a question
back sure.
there. Much time.
Sure.
I just, I don't want to forget it, but while you're on the subject of, like, school and stuff, mm-hmm. Do you find, like, in, like, the deaf community has, like, two communities. The, like, big deaf, which is, they believe, like, they don't need help. Well, they don't think they want help.
Right.
And then there's, it's like, those who, like, want the help and want to use residual hearing and get hearing aids and stuff like that. Do you find with the blind community that there's people who want the help and, like, the skills, like, the occupational therapy, like you're saying?
Yeah.
Or do you feel like everyone finds that it's useful?
It's nowhere near... like the deaf community. The deaf community is fascinating. You're absolutely right. The deaf community is very, at least, like you say, the big D, you know, self-inclusive, you know, it's kind of a closed little society. They're self-sufficient. I mean, I have had, you know, deaf people say that, you know, deaf couples who want their child to be deaf. You know, they feel like it's like an ethnic thing almost. You know, like, I want them to be raised in my culture. My culture is deaf. You know, I am personally horrified by that notion, you know, but that's their belief. It's not as strong in the blindness community. It's certainly not as big in the blindness community. There are some people, the National Federation for the Blind, NFB, is a pretty strong advocacy group. And they sometimes I know one of their things a few years ago was they felt that all mobility teachers, everybody who teaches travel skills should be blind. So the blind should be, you know, leading the blind. I don't believe in that. I like the fact that my mobility teacher can see across the street and know that there's, you know, there's a giant pole over there, and, you know, and that they can show me how to get past it. Like, I have no problem with that. I think most blind people don't have a problem with that. But there are some people who do feel, you know, that they would like to be more self-sufficient. It's nowhere near like the deaf community. And I have a theory about that, which I'll get to in 1 second. Let me just make sure you understand, going back to Perkins, that, you know, if you've got a multi-impaired blind child in a wheelchair, it might cost 5 times as much at Perkins for that student. So if you're in a small school district that doesn't have a lot of money and the parents want their kid to go to Perkins, and all of a sudden you have to absorb the cost of 5 students because it's 5 times as expensive, they're going to be reluctant to send a student to Perkins, and I understand that. And the thing you need to know about Perkins is we're not trolling for business. The secondary program has about 80 kids in it. That's about as much as we can handle, okay? The deaf-blind program has 54. Lower school, I think, has around 40. I forget. Altogether, on campus, we have about 250 kids, okay? We have a preschool. So we're not looking to steal kids from school districts because we need them. I mean, we're pretty much maxed out. The kids that we get are the kids that need to be there. And if they don't need to be there, we're happy to send them back. So just, you know, you might hear this, and I just want you to understand that, you know, we support inclusion when inclusion works. We want what's best for the student. You know, so just, I just want you to, you know, because it is something you'll hear about, okay?
You know, Jeff, the same analogy can be made for individuals who are deaf, individuals who are mentally retarded, some with autism. There needs to be places where children can go where they need this special attention, and it just isn't the blind community.
Absolutely.
But across the whole board, and some people in here have selected to work with the most severe individuals who are disabled. They wish to work with profound and severe. Yep. So some of those students who sit here today would probably be looking to work in places like Perkins and other places that serve.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. So. Now that's great to hear. And absolutely. And again, you know, in our school, you know, one of the great things, like I'm an advisor to the student council, and the student council We have kids with multiple disabilities on the student council. They get to advocate for policies. They got an elevator put in. They got a talking ATM put in. So they learn important skills about advocacy, about being part of a community that a lot of those kids didn't get in the public schools. Again, they were included. They were in the classroom. They were physically there, but they weren't participating. There are a lot of kids who aren't participating. Again, I'm not anti-public school and I'm not anti-inclusion. I want to be really clear about that. But there are times when it's more appropriate for them to come to Perkins. And those are the kids we love to work with. And we have lots of multi-impaired kids. We're having more and more multi-impaired kids. Because again, most blind kids can function fine in the public schools. They might need a little help. We have an outreach program where they can go on weekends and summers to get training. Or they might come to us for a year or two just till they pass MCAS and then go back to the public schools. And we love seeing kids go back to the public schools. One of the things that scares me about the public schools, God bless you. One of the things that scares me is we've sent a couple of really bright, really capable kids back to their public schools. They wanted to graduate with their senior class and they were all excited about it. When they got there, they were really disappointed. It wasn't what they expected. And one of the reasons is, and a lot of this has to do with liability and legal issues and fear, is that almost every kid I know who either is in the public school now or has come from the public school actually has an aide that travels with them, that walks the halls with them, sits in class with them, you know, collects their papers for them, goes to lunch with them. Now think about this. Imagine when you were in high school, if you had, you know, a school employee accompanying you everywhere you went, right? How included are you going to be in that community? How many friends are you going to make if you've got this guard with you, observing? I mean, I love to say to people, I learned some of my best skills without adult supervision. That's how I learned. The thought of having a person following me around is horrifying. Not to mention going back to that narcissism of disability. If they're collecting your papers, if they're putting things in your backpack, if they're getting your homework assignments, how are you learning how to do that if they're doing it for you? There are things in the public school that we'd like to see change so that would make it easier for our kids to really have what's so important about public school, which is the social things and the, you know, developing the social skills and that kind of stuff. So that's very important. But I want to go back to the blindness community and the deaf issue. And I wish I could remember where I read this. And I read it in college. And because I'd love to give the person credit for this. But I was actually reading a criticism of theater, of drama. It was a critic of drama who made this point. And he said that that if you have a deaf person, it's much more comfortable having a deaf character on stage than a blind character on stage. And the reason was that a deaf character, you know, think about a comedy, you know, a play where you have a deaf character. What happens? You know, the person who can hear goes up to him and says, "Excuse me, can you tell me where the bakery is?" "What? What'd you say? The bakery, where's the bakery? What? I can't hear you." The person you're laughing at is not the deaf person. You're laughing at the person who can hear, who's not being heard, right? That's the funny character. You know, they're going through, they're exasperated. "I'm talking about the, that kind of thing, right? That's funny, because you're not laughing at the disability, you're laughing at the person without the disability. If you put a blind character on stage, and they walk in and they trip over a coffee table, or they fall down, you're not gonna be comfortable laughing at them because of their disability. Because you see what they don't. You have information that they don't have, and that makes you uncomfortable, right? Whereas the deaf character, you can laugh because the deaf character is perfectly happy. He doesn't have the problem, it's the other person. Does that make sense? Do you get the concept? All right, now let me tell you, I used to write a column for the Watertown Tab for many years, before they stopped paying us. But I wrote this column because when, I'm gonna tie this all together for you, hopefully this makes sense. But when my daughter was born, I was able to carry her wherever she needed to go. Then there was a year or two, about a year, where it was really scary because she was running away a lot. She's 2 years old, she doesn't want to be held always, right? So going out, the two of us would be scary because she could, God forbid, she could run away, get hit, bit by a car or something. So there's this period of time when I had to be very careful. But then once she got a little bit older, you know, 5 years old or so, we would start walking everywhere together, all right? And so she became my guide. Even though I was the adult and she was the five-year-old, she could see where things were. So if I needed to go to the the deli to get, you know, chopped meat or, you know, sandwich meat or whatever, I didn't have to figure out where the store was because she was with me. And I loved doing things with her, and she liked being with me. And so we would go out, and we would do all these errands, and I wouldn't have to pay attention. And so that worked fine for a long time. People called her my sidekick. Every now and then, people would always say, hey, well, you know. Well, she got to be 13, 14. All of a sudden, it wasn't so cool walking around with your old man all the time. She had friends she wanted to be with, right? Makes sense, right? Normal, healthy thing. So she came to me, and she said, listen, you know, you know, you're going to have to go on your own. You're going to have to go. You know, I got other things to do. But she was the one who said, but I'm going to show you the landmarks. So there was the deli, there's a tree in front of the deli. So, you know, so we spent time. We'd walk up and she'd say, okay, so when you get to this tree, right across, you know, she was being a little mobility instructor. You get to this tree, you turn around and there's the store. There's a trash can at the foot of the ramp to the Tedeschi's Market. So once you hit that, you know you're at Tedeschi's. Whatever it was, we literally went around town and she pointed out all these things to me. And then I was back on my own again. You know, she was off with her friends and I was traveling by myself in the community again. And so I would have all my landmarks. Now, the thing that would happen is, let's say I wanted to go to the Tedeschi's where there's a garbage can in front, you know. I would trail along the side of the store, get to the can with my cane, and then go around it and go up the ramp, right? Now, how many times people would be driving by and see me walking towards the garbage can? I know what I'm doing. I'm going to hit that garbage can with my cane. That's going to tell me where the ramp is. I'm going to go around, and I'm going to go up. And they start yelling out the window, look out, look out, garbage can, right? I'd be like, what? Because they have information they think I don't have, right? They can see the garbage can. They don't know that I know the garbage can is there. And so they have information, and that puts them in a parental role, right? They have information. In the same way that as my daughter was growing up, I could see down the road, right? I could say, oh, when she gets to high school, this, that, and, you know, I could, not literally see, but figuratively see, right? I could see, well, you know, and I worried for her. As a parent, I wanted her to avoid all the obstacles that we all know you guys have to go through growing up, right? But as a parent, we want to protect them from that. So, you know, I would be telling her about the pitfalls. She'd be telling me about the garbage can, right? And I learned that's why I say a parental role. When somebody sees things that you don't see, they feel responsible. If they don't tell you, you're going to fall, you're going to get hurt. I think this applies now when blind people go for work. Okay, 70% of blind people underemployed or unemployed, right? Because they come into the room and you're talking, and you know, people I think are generally want to be helpful. You know, might want to hire you, but they have all these fears about, well, what's going to happen if, you know, again, liability, what if they fall down the stairs? What if they screw up? It's going to be so hard to fire them because when, you know, ADA, disability stuff, once they're on, you know, it's easy to hire, it's hard to fire, right? Especially if you have a disability. And so there's a reluctance because they're in the parental role. There are studies that show that people who use guide dogs are easier to employ. And I think the reason is because now everybody sees the dog as the surrogate adult. You know, they don't have to worry. The dog will take care of him. The dog will protect him. The dog will do it. And so it makes them more comfortable with that person. This is my theory. Again, we do know that people using guide dogs get employed, and I think that's why. You are more likely to be employed. And I think because it takes the anxiety away from the sighted person. Now there's this living creature, and when we have all these, you know, dog is man's best friend, and you know, it's sort of built into our psyche that they're helpful. So I think that's what happens. And whereas if you just have a blind person walking in, you automatically go on alert. You're slightly more uncomfortable because you know things that they don't know, and that makes you uncomfortable. In the same way that you'll laugh at you know, the deaf character on, you know, the people around the deaf character on stage because it's safe to laugh. It's not safe to laugh at a blind person falling down on stage. Does that make sense? Anybody confused? Or, right? Make sense? how are we doing on time, Doc?
We have about 8 minutes.
8 minutes, all right. All right, let me get to Helen Keller. I know you guys asked about Helen, or somebody asked about Helen Keller and Annie Sullivan. let me tell you about this. Growing up, I had a real love-hate relationship with Helen Keller. because it seemed like whenever we met somebody and my parents would say, you know, oh yeah, that's my son Jeff, he's blind, right? They'd be like, oh gee, that's just too bad. Oh, Helen Keller! Remember Helen Keller? You know, and I would hear about it, and I'd be like, why does Helen Keller got to do with me, right? what am I going to do? I'm going to grow up and do what? Travel the world and drink tea with Eleanor Roosevelt? What? What does this mean, right? So, you know, I really was kind of like, you know, the heck with Helen Keller. Actually, I use language stronger than that. But, and then I started teaching. And then I started focusing on Annie Sullivan. Annie Sullivan is a fascinating, amazing woman. she was somebody who was, you know, poor. She had behavior issues. At one point, she was literally put in a cage when she was about 17 because she was violent, because people didn't know that she had cataracts, that she had early, you know, this was the 1800s. Finally, she, she had, you know, surgery. She got to Perkins. She was visually impaired, but she had some vision. And then she gets asked to go to Alabama and teach this deaf-blind girl who's had, you know, talk about the narcissism of disability, had been not taught anything, was given anything she wanted. She could eat off of her, you know, just grab stuff off everybody's plate. She just, God knows, you know, she was a terror, right? There was no special ed classes. There was no training. There was no college program. There was nothing. There's this woman, Boston Irish, 19, 20 years old, going to work down south with this deafblind child, okay? And somehow she figured out. So I want to go back to what I said to you about how you create this world in your brain, right? You, all of you, we all take all this input and we create a world. And then we, as teachers, we take what's in our heads and we transfer it to the next generation, right? Because as mammals, our number one function is to procreate. As humans, our number one, you know, our number one function is to educate, you know, our young. You know, if we're going to bring them into the world, we're going to teach them so they can carry on after us, right? That makes perfect sense, right? Procreate, educate, right? So you take the world in, and you have it in your head, and then you take it from your head, and you teach the next generation what you know, give them the tools, so then they can take what you know, and then they can bring it forward, and they can learn more, and then they can pass it on to the next generation. That's what education is about, right? So now think about the classic story of Annie Sullivan and Helen Keller at the pump, right? You guys know the story, miracle worker. Do you guys know what I'm talking about? Anybody need a little more background? Okay, the kid has no language, knows nothing. She just, you know, she's a wild child. Annie Sullivan's trying to teach her by spelling, you know, water into her hand and showing her water and, you know, spelling, you know, mom and then having her touch mom and spelling dad and everything, you know. So in her head, Annie Sullivan has this, this wealth of information, has this vision. And she's sending impulses down her arms, you know, electrical impulses down to her fingertips into the hand of this blind child and trying to get that blind child to receive those signals, have them travel up her arm, up to her brain, and in that brain create the world that Annie Sullivan sees for her, right? That makes sense? You see that? And then, you know, so she's trying and she's trying and she's trying, and this child is spitting and yelling and scratching and stomping and running away and running away. And one day at the well, as the story goes, the child is screaming, she's spelling, and all of a sudden, it clicks. That what she feels in her hand is what, in the one hand, is what she's is the name for what she's feeling running through her fingers on the other hand. And she makes the connection. This is water. This word means this thing. And she immediately begins to run around and want to know the names of everything around her environment, right? This is the great scene in the, what's this, and 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 she gets, all right? So to me, what happens is Annie Sullivan has this world in her brain. She sends the impulses down her arm, into the fingers, up the arm, to the brain, gets the brain to click on. Then the brain sends messages back down the arm, into the fingertips, into the hand of Annie Sullivan. What's this? What's this? It goes back and forth. That to me is a metaphor for all education, right? It doesn't matter whether you do it verbally by me talking to you, or you do it by writing something down that somebody else reads 100 years later, 1,000 years later, and learns from. You know, it doesn't matter if it's a videotape that somebody watches, you know, down the road in another country. It's all about getting that stuff from your head into the head of someone else and back and forth, right? And what a beautiful, beautiful image of the hands, okay? That's not the only way you do it. It's not the only way to teach, but it's a beautiful image for all of education. And so what I'd like to say now is I no longer have a love-hate relationship with Helen Keller and Annie Sullivan. It's pure love. I mean, I truly love that metaphor. To me, if you did a mural of education throughout history, you know, with Socrates and Plato over here and, you know, some kind of advanced fancy technology over there, dead center in the middle of that mural, to me, is Annie Sullivan and Helen Keller at that pump. I think that's all we need to hang on to as far as this is what, not just special. I don't like the term special education because every child is special, right? Every child needs to be educated. You're not special because you're working with disabled people. I mean, I'm not that hard to work with, right? You know, it's all part of, you know, education. All education is special. Those people who are being shot in Afghanistan and Pakistan for trying to educate young women, they're special. You know, when I go to work every day, I'm not going to get shot. I might get a pain once in a while from some of my students, but that's about it. That's what's, you know, but it's education. It's all education. It's just different ways of educating. You know, it's all about, you know, finding what fits, you know, so maybe it's residential school, maybe it's, you know, public school, maybe it's a, you know, maybe it's an art school, or maybe it's a technology school, whatever it is, every student deserves a free and appropriate for them education. And so to me, let's have it all on the table. Every option should be available. That's what education is about. And I really am so thankful that you invited me here, and I'm really glad to hear about what you're doing. And I hope I've given you a few things to think about going forward. And if you have any questions, we still have a few minutes, right?
Well, it's just about time.
Okay.
We've had one, and I'm going to sit back and just let someone take the second question. We'll call it a day.
Okay.
Who wants to? Brett, I'm going to hold you off for a second.
Oh, come on, I got one more question.
Okay, go.
Okay, so you know how you talk about narcissism?
Yep.
So on campus, there's a few people who are blind and they use the long canes.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm always like afraid to like ask them if they need help. Like, you know how they hold on to the back of the arm and you can like...
Yeah, sighted guide. Yep, yeah. The elbow, yep.
Yeah, and like you said about the trash can, how you like hit the trash can and you know where you're going. Like, I see that all the time and it makes sense now, at least if they're doing the same thing. But, like, do you find that appropriate to ask, or do you not, like...
What's the key word that you just said? No? You said ask, right? Right? That's all you have to do, right? Don't assume, okay? I mean, I can't tell you how many times I've stood at a corner and had somebody grab me and start dragging me across the street when I wasn't going across the street.
Oh.
You know? So, you know, if you ask and say, you know, hi, I'm so-and-so, you know, can I help you or whatever? That people, you know, and, you know, a lot of those people you see are former students of mine. So you can always say to them, you know, I know Jeff. But, you know, we don't get offended. I mean, every now and then you'll find a blind person who's going to be offended. They don't speak for all of us. I mean, if you ask and you're friendly and you're, you know, that's all you really need to do. I mean, it's when people assume they know what you want that it becomes difficult.
Okay, we've reached that point in our morning before we go back. Jeff, I want to thank you. Before we move on, though, I'm going to ask Jess, though, come over here and do the honors.
Oh, okay.
So we wanted to give you this T-shirt as a token of our appreciation.
Oh, I love this. Thank you. I'm afraid to ask you what size it is, but well it's okay.
Well, I'm trusting Jeff. Jess was able to measure you a little bit. She called over a couple and said, this must fit. But, you know, in all honesty, I sit here and I think you have something in your hands that will play well back at Perkins. And what I mean by that, you should put that on sometime and you walk the halls over there. And as you pass by Mike Catarazzola, you should put your chest out a little bit and say, hey, Mike, I bet you don't have one of these.
You don't have one of these. Exactly. I'm going to do that as soon as the weather warms up.
Okay.
All right.
And another thing, too, because I don't want to leave here without some appreciation for what Perkins is. Some of you know. I mean, if you haven't been to Perkins, you are truly missing one of the great institutions in the world. You really are. It is huge.
It's a beautiful campus.
Some of you think of it being maybe one building. It's huge. No. You have to go out and see it and walk the grounds and appreciate what this fine institution is all about. I mean, when you think of Helen Keller and Jeff and so forth, we're talking people. But the institution is such an enrichment of knowledge and education and programming and facilities and so forth that truly do turn out really world-class individuals who just happen to be blind.
Our charter predates the Massachusetts free public education system. Our charter is 1829. I think Horace Mann got free public education in Massachusetts like 1844, maybe 46, something like that. So we're about 20 years ahead of people were being educated at Perkins before average people were being educated anywhere else in the state. So that's pretty amazing.
And one more thing before you say, I have had hundreds of students visit Perkins. But the other thing is I've had tens of students after graduation over the years look at Perkins as maybe a stopgap measure for you. Mm-hmm. Students have literally found out about Perkins, about the employment possibilities out there. I've had students go on to Perkins and live there for 2 years, be employed, and use downtown Boston as their jumping off point for their master's or doctoral degree.
We have a lot of teaching assistants who do exactly that, who live on campus, work, and take classes at UMass Boston, get degrees, come back and teach, or teach in the public schools. It's a great resource. You know me now, feel free to, stop by and say hello, email me. I'm easy to locate. I'd be happy to help anybody who's interested. We're always glad to pass it along because someday I hope to retire. Once my daughter's college loans are paid off. So we need a next generation. So.
And we're all always talking about our college loans and our college bills and can I afford to go into graduate school? There's many and sundry ways for you to figure that out. But at least there's one at Perkins that has been a godsend for some students. So think about it. Right. You don't have to go into orientation mobility. You can choose whatever master's program you want and maybe use Perkins as a jumping off point to keep the cost of that education.
And I'll tell you, those TAs have a lot of fun. We're not supposed to know about it, but they have a lot of fun. So it's a pretty nice place to, it's a great way, like you say, to get educated and to make ends meet. So.
Well, Jeff, in closing, I do want to thank you for coming, but I want you to send word back to Mike Catarazzola this morning that he was really missed here.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
Hopefully he will be sitting in this chair having that conversation, which is something we've always wanted to do for some 30-odd years, and someday we will.
Yeah.
But thank you for coming.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Really appreciate it.